What's up, everybody? This is the Bad at Halo Show, the web show and podcast for your average, everyday Halo gamer. I'm your host, Tazman, and if you're watching live on Beam, thank you so much for joining. The show is streamed live on Sunday nights at 9 p.m. Eastern on beam.pro/Bad Halo Show. I made sure it rhymed so you can remember it. But if you can't join us live, first of all, for shame. But there is always the audio version available on iTunes, and hey, while you're there, why not take a couple of minutes to rate and review the show? Ratings and reviews, they help to spread the good word about the podcast, just like my team T-Squared teammate from the Gold 2v2 Drunken Halo Tournament, T-Lock24, did most recently with his review. So this is a five-star review titled, Don't Be Fooled by the Name. He says, and quote, "It may be called the Bad Halo Show, but it is far from it. In fact, it's great. Tez does an excellent job of reviewing each week's Halo community update, HCS news, and hot button topics. If there is ever a show to get your Halo news each week, then this is your podcast. Death, Taxes, Bad Halo Show. Yours truly, T-Lock." Well, thank you for that, T-Lock, your review, and you are now part of the Bad Halo Pity Committee, so I appreciate that. And you've got yourself an entry into the drawing for 1 free year of Xbox Live. Don't forget, you have 3 ways to enter: writing a review on iTunes, just like T-Lock did. You can follow me on Twitter at Bad Halo Show, and by joining the Bad at Halo Show Discord, and I will have a link in the description. For those of you that are on Beam, the link is off on the left part of your screen right there. Be sure to include your gamer tag in each, and there's 3 ways right there for you to enter. And remember, if you refer someone to any of those 3 entries and they mention your gamer tag, that person gets an entry, and so do you. So there is no limit on the entries you can have, and the more entries you get, the more prizes that I'll make available. And then winner or winners will be drawn live on the podcast on May 21st. But enough of that, because today I have 2 very special guests that are going to be joining me via Skype, and we're going to talk the most recent comments regarding the Halo 5 campaign, what they've learned, and what that might mean for Halo moving forward. So without further ado, let's spawn in, because this is episode 35, Did 343 Learn Their Story Lesson? And it starts right now.
Set, start.
Let's get started. I'm going to introduce my guest, and I'll go ahead and I'll start my guest. This guest takes the podcast international, because I don't count Canada as international. He is from the YouTube realm, doing video-based podcasts as co-founder of Progressive Halo, and a member and contributor to the Halo Archive, the Venezuelan sensation that's sweeping the nation, HaruspexofHell. Joe, how you doing?
I'm doing good.
Good.
Thank you.
I'm doing fantastic. It's hot as balls in Arizona, but you know, I am making do. I had to turn my fan off during the introduction, so I'm already starting to feel it, but I think I'll be all right. All right.
I mean, I guess we're both born in the heat.
Well, I wasn't born in the heat. I moved to the heat, so that makes me crazy.
Oh, that's even worse.
Excuse me, my second guest is a fellow member of the Halo podcasting community. Every week you can hear him on the Let's Talk Halo podcast with his Canadian cohort, Real Mystery, the man with the golden voice for podcasting, the Jr. Ace. Ace, what's up, buddy?
Hey, what's going on, guys? How's it cracking?
It cracks on, I guess, would be the proper response to that, would it?
Quite warm.
Yeah, quite warm. Yeah. Gabe, how are you doing? You're back from France. Been back for a couple weeks now, right?
Yeah, I've been back for what, 2-3 weeks, something like that.
Any more world stops coming up in the near future for you?
I will be leaving Tuesday morning to South Carolina. I will be down there for a week, and then I venture back up here to catch my best friend for a couple days, and then we'll see where the road takes me. I mean, Never know.
Yeah, you kind of go as the wind blows sometimes, don't you?
I do. I may actually do the Brooklyn Half Marathon sometime in May. I don't know if I want to do it yet.
Well, you might want to train for that one, unlike the Paris Marathon.
This one's half. If I did the full without training, I need even less training for this.
Need even less training. So don't do anything at all.
Yeah, eat more cake.
Hey, you know, let them eat cake, as somebody famous once said. So let's talk about you guys for a second, and maybe your just kind of brief history and introduction to Halo, what it is you guys do, what got you into Halo, and a little bit about your community involvement. So, Joe, why don't we go ahead and start with you?
Well, I'm going to start with how I started with Halo, which is straight from the doorstep of Halo, Halo CE. And, well, I was born in 1997, so I was a pretty little kid. So I was blown away by Halo, and I stuck with it ever since. And with the community, I just work with Halo Archive. I pretty closely with Halo Archive. I work with Halo Team Assemble pretty closely as well. And I work in my own blog post, which is HaruspexofHell.wordpress.com. And I created Hip Progressive Halo with my friends Adopter Knowledge and Metalhead Spartan.
Easy for you to say.
And yeah, that's why I call him David, not by his name.
Where did the Haruspex of Hell tag come from?
Well, it is a pretty small story, which is I wanted something similar to what Haruspex is, which is a protector of the domain, mm-hmm. or, well, a cataloger of the domain. And I went with the old word of Haruspex, which is Haruspex, which derives from ancient Rome. And don't look it up, because it is disgusting when you find out what it actually means, but I stuck with it.
Standard order for everybody listening, do not look up Haruspex. Okay, gotcha.
Yeah.
And so,
but I guess that's basically it.
Excellent. And so, Ace, your turn. Talk about yourself a little bit. When you got started with Halo, what hooked you, and your role with Let's Talk Halo.
Yeah. So, I got into Halo. I think my stepdad and I bought it like day two CE when it came out. And we played that. We went to the midnight sale to get two, same thing with three. And then I stopped playing Halo before ODST came out and didn't really pick it back up till MCC. Though I did play Reach and 4, the campaigns, with one of my nephews, because he was younger and like was all into video games and he had them. But I just ran through the campaign with him and then I was like, okay, I'm good. And here I am. I got back in MCC. I love 5. Mystery and I decided to make a pretty much just record the stuff we chatted about anyway. And that's our show. Let's Talk Halo.
Right on. All right, guys. So thank you both for being able to come on in. I know on short notice, Gabe, I had lined up sort of fairly early, but Joe was a late addition. Thank you very much, guys, for stepping up and having this conversation with me this week. I really do appreciate it. So let's, for those of you guys that are listening, if you're like the Junior Ace and don't have a Twitter account, you may or may not be aware of a recent Games TM article that featured Frank O'Connor and Kiki Wolfkill kind of talking about some of the lessons that they had learned from the fan community and industry reception over Halo 5's story. And I pulled some of the quotes. There was an IGN.com article that kind of reviewed. I couldn't get a hold of the actual Games TM article.
But yeah, I couldn't. I saw like a picture of it, but you couldn't actually read it. I was using the IGN article. That's the one that I really read, and that's the one by Matt Porter.
Yeah. And I used that. And then also Chief Canuck did a quick overview of it as well on his YouTube channel. And I use that for reference as well. I actually looked for a physical copy of the Games TM magazine at Barnes & Noble, and they had already moved on to the next issue. So, oh well. But anyway, guys, what I'll do is I'll just kind of go through some of the quotes. And then as we go through the quotes, if you guys have some things you kind of want to jump in and say, or what you kind of take away from these, just kind of feel free to jump in and kind of say, you know, what some of your reactions have are to some of these quotes. So the first quote that I'm going to talk about that we pull up, and then and all these and I noticed all of these quotes are actually from Frank O'Connor. I don't know if Kiki Wolfkill was just there to look pretty or what, but a lot of these just came from Frank.
What I saw, because I found a Eurogamer.net article that covers the original Gamer TM,
okay,
or Games TM. Looks like Kiki talked a lot about, or not a lot, but she did have some comments about MCC and sort of the disappointment of how that didn't work out.
Okay, that was the part I remember. She tackled MCC. Frank kind of tackled the Halo 5 story.
Yeah, he did the more story-oriented aspect of the article, of the interview.
And honestly, to be fair, I kind of ignored the MCC stuff just because we all know how much of a disaster that was. I didn't really kind of take anything there that was new or groundbreaking, or it was just kind of like we know you guys messed up, and it's kind of nice to see that you guys even acknowledge, we had a lot to learn from that.
Yeah, but I think it's good that she did say, like, it's sort of, she says that it was heartbreaking, like, working all this way to try to earn the trust and then immediately just losing it.
Mm-hmm.
So, I don't know, there's some honesty there.
Especially after Halo 4.
I mean, it is pretty heartbreaking.
Yeah, and I mean, especially after Halo 4, I mean, the multiplayer wasn't that well received, but the campaign was. So, you know, at that point when MCC is releasing, 343 in the eyes of the fans is still somewhat 50-50. And this was an idea that, at least on paper, I think they felt like this is something that could really win the community over. And it kind of fell on their face.
It was too ambitious for their own good. That's why I pretty much believe that they should have done it with separate interfaces and not just one interface and intertwine everything else. Yeah. They pretty much mucked it up, everything there.
Well, and there's all sorts of stuff in there. I mean, you have a number of different publishers or a number of different developers working on a number of different things, and none of it integrated in the way that they were planning for it to, or that they expected it to. And I mean, to this day, people still have issues with it, and it's been what, 3 years, 4 years?
Yeah.
Well, they still give it updates. Like they still do stuff to it.
Yep.
Which is insane. I mean, did that game come out 2 years before 5?
I think so.
It was announced in 2013, and I think it came out in 2013, the same year, I think.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Because I remember if you had it, then that also gave you access to the beta for 5, correct?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the beta for 5 was really good.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think I got it, like, as the beta, like, right before the beta started. And I just had no idea what the hell was going on.
Yeah. So, we'll talk about, let's get into some of the quotes that Frank had about the reactions, at least to the story. And so, the first one says, and it says, quote, "We took some digs for storytelling in Halo 5, but they were absolutely merited. We very much realized that people wanted Master Chief's story in Halo 5. We definitely marketed it in a way that we hoped was going to bring surprise, but for some fans, and certainly fans of Master Chief, it was a huge disappointment because they wanted more Chief. They loved Blue Team, they liked Osiris, but they wanted Chief, and that has been a big learning," end quote. So reading through that, I mean, what's some of your guys' first kind of takeaways from some of those comments?
I mean, Chief is not the only thing that Halo is. And so when I hear you say that, it's pretty much just, that wasn't the only thing that they did wrong and the only thing that they need to fix. They need to fix this story, and giving more Chief in the mids is not going to fix it.
In what way do you mean fix the story?
do something that actually fixes the created storyline that doesn't seem like it is the mess it is right now. Because the created storyline just dropped everything else that they had created in books, in games, everything. And it just was heartbreaking for many lore fans.
Yeah, no, I understand that. But, I mean, it's easy to just say fix the story. But, like, I guess what would you do with it? How would you approach it?
Well, right now, as a writer, I have no idea.
Well, as a fan.
That's a thing.
Yeah. I mean, as a fan, where would you like it to go? You too, Taz. Well, what do you think?
Well, I mean, I don't know. I mean, it's something where it was just like, and maybe it was, I was set up for, I mean, they brought up the marketing campaign, right? And so I was set up for this story of, are we going in? Are we chasing after Chief? What's going on with him? Is he a traitor? Has he turned sides? That this was what I was expecting, and I expected the game to have some sort of payoff from that marketing. That never happened. And I think for me, it was kind of like they talked about wanting it to be a surprise. The surprise was is that the marketing had absolutely nothing to do with the game, even though they advertised it as this major plot point of the game, even though, you know, they brought this the Hunt the Truth podcast out and the greatest hunt in video game history and all these things that were supposed to be building towards this payoff that never happened. I mean, the showdown that we get between Chief and Locke is basically an exaggerated tickle fight that comes in halfway through the game and really never gets resolved. It just kind of goes into the, after that, it's like, oh, something must be messed up, so we're just going to follow these guys. And it ends up becoming a game of follow the leader, not hunt the Chief. So I think that if that's the route you were going to go and that's the direction you were going to go, you know, that's the payoff that we expect. And then all this stuff with Cortana and the created, it just seemed to me on my end just to be very cliche science fiction, especially nowadays with AIs taking over the world and stuff like that. It just seemed like it was, I don't know if easy is the answer. It almost seemed like an easy way out to create a villain out of artificial intelligence.
And it is. It really is an easy way out. And mostly in the way that I have reason to believe the Halo 5 was actually going to be a spin-off game and not actually a Halo 5 game. So it was going to be vastly different from what I know. But I'm not really going to go into detail because it's mostly going to be regarded as nothing but, I don't know, speculation.
We're talking about where it was supposed to go and where it actually ended up heading.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, there's...
Yeah. Well, in terms...
Well, they've said that, like, they had to cut a lot of it out. And you can tell, like, in all the cutscenes, none of those cutscenes seem complete. They don't seem full.
Yeah.
But I have to ask, like, why do you think it was a spin-off game? Like, you can't just drop that and say, I'm not going to go into it.
Well, go into the cut stuff for Halo 5. The Infinity Hot World was going to be really prominent in the story. We're going to be able to actually go in different worlds, in different planets that we could choose ourselves and be at the Infinity Hot World. And that's why I think it was going to be a spin-off game and not so much a Halo 5 game. And then Halo 5 would have come after.
Didn't the lead up to Halo 5, it didn't even include the number 5 in it for the longest time, if I remember.
Yeah, it didn't.
So maybe it was intended to start as a spin-off game and then just turned into a game in the mainline series somewhere down the line?
Yeah, that's how I'm guessing it went. It should have gone if it stuck to their guns.
Yeah, so I like I said, was out of video games, so I missed really the lead up to it. So there was talk that you would be on the Infinity as like a hub, and you would be able to choose planets. This is news to me.
There's actually concept art for it as well.
Oh, interesting. I've not seen this.
Yeah, that's news to
me. I can send it to you guys later.
Yeah, can we put it in the show notes, Taz?
Yeah.
Yeah, send me the link. I'll put it in the show notes.
Yeah, please. I would like to see this as well. I've never... Well, like I said, I didn't follow anything with video games, so it's all news.
Yeah, in the lead up, yeah.
Yeah, I came back just in time for... I caught, like, the very end of... Oh, shoot. What was the podcast? You just mentioned it.
Hunt the Truth?
Hunt the Truth, season one.
Great podcast.
Which was amazing. Yeah, amazing.
Great podcast.
Like, I turned tons of people onto it who know nothing about video games. They were like, dude, this is great. I'm like, it's really good. Season two was good. Yeah. I didn't like how...
Yeah.
It was good. Yeah. But I didn't like how they were like, oh, it's going to tie in directly to the game, and it really sort of didn't. Like, that's really what got me. And they even teased how they were supposed to be, I think, was it Frank O'Connor who said that, like, one of the characters from Hunt the Truth season two would be in the game?
It was somebody that did the podcast said that.
Oh, it was one of the producers then, yeah. Right? The two. I remember hearing this. And, like, I've looked through that game. I have not found anyone.
I spent an exorbitant amount of time on the Meridian Hub Station.
Yes.
Looking for somebody that tied into the Hunt the Truth.
I talked to everyone to get all their, like, phrases out.
I talked to everybody that let me talk to, and they're trying to find this character, and left, obviously, with quite the disappointment. I believe that character has still yet to be found in the game.
It's.
I don't think he is actually in the game.
No, I don't think so either, because I've looked. Every mission on Meridian... I went through that with a fine tooth comb on every single mission that had to do with Meridian, and I did not find anybody.
Same thing when like collecting all the artifacts. I was like, maybe they find, like, you know, a message in a bottle type thing that you throw in space and it made it here. No, nothing.
No.
In his defense, I will say, as we said before, there's a lot in the game that was clearly cut out. So we don't know if, as far as they knew, someone was supposed to make an appearance.
So, but then,
I mean,
going back to the
in
marketing.
In terms of cut stuff, in terms of cut stuff, it was most likely gonna make it. Someone was most likely gonna make it into the game, but it didn't happen.
At some point,
like a lot in this game.
At some point in that development, when they had to cut things or change direction, and Chief Canuck in his video made a great point. All your marketing, every character that you have. Is wearing a helmet. How can you not redub the marketing? How can you not make sure to change that so that way you're not setting up for this thing that doesn't ever actually happen in the game?
The whole buildup, as you were saying earlier, like, it made it into this whole thing that it actually was not. And that was just a big disappointment on their end. And they acknowledged it in the article.
Yeah.
Like, it didn't work out. The fan reception was not at all what they expected. And, you know, that's why they're going back. They said no new playable characters, right?
Yeah, we'll get to that here. I got that quote a little bit later on.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, well, I don't mean to jump the gun.
No worries. But, like, the other thing that I kind of take out of this quote, too, is, you know, when Frank O'Connor takes, you know, we took some digs and they were absolutely merited. I mean, that's a very... different response as compared to, I don't know if you guys are familiar with Frank O'Connor's Time Magazine article that came out around the time Halo 5 was released, where he really did a lot of ducking and dodging of the story criticisms, even to a point where he said that the fans were too young to understand subtlety and nuance as far as the campaign went. So this is a very big about-face turn a year and a half later.
Yeah,
I wholeheartedly agree with you, but there is a part of me that does sort of agree with him, that there are people who didn't really experience playing CE or 2, or even 3, until, like, MCC.
Yeah.
And, like, the story's a little different if you've played Reach and 4 before you played the other ones, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
It's, you don't have that same attachment that a lot of the fan base does have.
Sure.
And that's not to say that, you know... he's in the right, but I'm sure they just didn't go through with it the way they should have, I guess, is just, and we all know that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And whoever it was that made that change, and my irresponsible speculation says that they brought a story to Microsoft that really kind of raised some questions about whether or not Chief was a traitor or not. And I think Microsoft got uneasy and they saw their big cash cow for Xbox maybe kind of fleeting in that and said, no, you guys need to turn around and change this.
It's the Star Wars Rogue One conundrum.
Yeah.
They got David Garrett to direct and write it. And I think he directed it. I don't know if he wrote all of it. Oh, no, he did write it. Mm-hmm. And then he makes this dark, epic war movie. And Disney is like, we can't have a movie that's kind of dark like this. So they bring in, what's his name from Traffic? Tony Gilroy, to come in and rewrite it. And there's lots of things in Rogue One that don't make sense. Like, scene to scene, you're like, what? This clearly two different movies.
Yeah.
But it comes down from the top. What are you supposed to do?
Sure.
And he can't throw them under the bus, which is why that Time article that you were saying, like, can you really blame him?
No.
The game just launched. He can admit right there it's a failure. Or it's a failure in terms of that it's not going to reach the numbers they wanted or the reception that they wanted at the time.
He can't throw them under the bus because those people that worked really, really hard on it are still at the studio. The game just launched, so he's still trying to move units. I mean, these articles, I mean, he's basically a salesman at this point, still trying to move.
He's doing what he has to do.
Absolutely. So yeah, I'm not necessarily saying that I don't blame him. I find it interesting as you look backwards that you hear the comments then, you hear the comments now, and it kind of goes, I wonder when you actually started to think this, and was the time just, you know, was that the PR piece that you were trying to spin positive PR, which is honestly, that's part of his job. So it's not like I blame him for that. That's damage totally control. His role. It's interesting when you look backwards from this point and see how that goes. And then we've already seen some changes internally at 343 regarding story and writing. Brian Reed's tenure as lead writer has ended. I looked on the Microsoft Jobs website, and the lead writer position is not there anymore.
Ooh.
So interesting. I'm sure we'll hear something there. Josh Holmes is no longer an executive producer at 343. So we've seen changes even at the very top being made, and arguably as a result of, or at least had a large reason or a large part of it being due to the critical reception of Halo 5's story. Again, some irresponsible speculation there, but I think you can kind of see a correlation.
Do we know what either has gone on to do?
No. I can look it up real quick if we need to. I mean,
we don't need to.
Josh Holmes went to his own company and doing his own thing, I think.
Okay, well, that would make sense.
I'll know how much crap has been piled onto Brian Reed. I think he was definitely turned into the scapegoat for Halo 5. My position with this is like, look, and I don't know about you guys, I don't know if you guys have ever been in a position of management, you know, for your jobs. I have. So I know, I kind of understand, it sucks and I don't like how it works, but I understand how it works as a person in a position of lead. If everything goes really, really well and everything succeeds, everybody says how great of a job you've done, and whether it was up to you or not, you know, then it's your responsibility as that lead to say, well, it wasn't just me. I have all these wonderful people that, you know, made me look good. But then if everything comes back and his critical reception's low or things messed up and they look at you, it's kind of your responsibility as that lead to kind of shoulder that and say, yep, you know, I messed up. I'll work with my team. We'll make it right and kind of move on. So even though he might have been, you know, a scapegoat for the game, you know, at the beginning and end of the day, you know, somebody has to be responsible for the narrative direction of the game. And unfortunate as it may be, you kind of look at the person that's in charge and say, okay, the buck needs to stop with you. And that might be a harsh way to look at it. I just know as somebody who's been in a position of management, I just know that's kind of how it goes, and it sucks, right, wrong, or otherwise, but it's just kind of the way that it is and how it goes.
And I mean, as a writer myself, I can sympathize with what Ryan Reed went through. Because you can tell that he was actually trying to do something good, but then he got destroyed.
Yeah. I'm going to take a wrestling analogy here. And sometimes they tell you you need to take chicken shit and turn it into chicken salad. He was given chicken shit, and he wasn't able to make it very palatable for people to take.
Yeah. I can't agree with that.
How about some of the comments about Frank O'Connor's reception or feelings of how the community received Blue Team and Osiris? He says people loved Blue Team and they liked Osiris. What do you guys, in general, what do you guys kind of feel about that?
I love Blue Team and I pretty much like what Osiris stands for, and I want to see them developed. So I'm pretty happy that he said that. I mean, I'm pretty happy that actually some people actually like Osiris. And people actually love Blue Team since before Halo 5 came out, so...
So, okay, well, how about for people that maybe didn't read Fall of Reach or any of the extended lore, I mean, what is it about Blue Team that is lovable as compared to, like, Osiris?
Well, they're an actual team. There's actual stakes in their emotions. In, like, First Strike, there's Last Light, there's Default Reach, and yeah, every single one of those books shows real character in them that ultimately gets ignored in Halo 5.
Yeah, what you're saying is true. They're showing development of like how these Spartans got to where they are, the people that we know coming into Halo 5. But for people that don't read the lore, who are they?
Well, I'm going to go with the rundown, deconstructed. I can't English tonight, apparently, but...
It's alright, I can't English ever.
We can always go to Spanish, we're good, I'm in.
Oh, you guys are good. I live in Arizona and I can't speak Spanish, which is not a good thing.
Su culpa de él que no habla, come on.
International flavor on and the bad at Halo show.
The people watching are not going to understand either, so it's also a problem there. But what I was going to say is... The deconstructor argument to explain who Blue Team are basically Fred is a tactician. He's an expert tactician. He's a jokester. He actually gets out of situations that are tedious by making jokes, but you don't see that in Halo 5. Kelly is a tech savvy. She can make anything happen with tech. She is pretty fast. She is skilled with a shotgun. And then there's Linda, which she is pretty quiet, like John. She's the only one that rivals John in being quiet. She's an amazing sniper. She actually killed a Banshee pilot through a canopy of a Banshee while hanging upside down. So
I can
in terms
that.
Of her characters... Oh, yeah, you totally can.
No, yeah, and, dude, I've read all the books. I love the lore. Blue Team's fucking awesome. I dig Osiris. I don't like the actor who plays Locke. I don't like him in... I just don't think he's a good actor. But that aside, for those people that just played the Halo games, they don't know who these people are.
And they're not given an introduction in-game.
They're not. There's literally... One of the deeper looks into Chief's character in that scene with Blue Team, the opening cutscene to the mission Blue Team in Halo 5, and then that's it. And you're just like, okay, so clearly Chief is comfortable with these people, but we don't know these people. Do you know what I mean? I thought they did a good job over the first couple missions and cutscenes showing that Osiris is, you know, they're a team. They you know, they're all Spartan 4s. They all have personality, which is what the Spartan 2s obviously, I don't want to say lack, but they're much more rigid. So if you don't, you know, if you don't have the lore background, it's okay. Why are these three people here with me? Chief has never needed anyone.
Yeah.
So that would be like, I can see how that would be very strange if you don't know. My nephew, the one who played the Reach and Halo 4 campaigns with me, like, he was like, I don't know what the Flood are. And then, you know, we went back and played Halo 1, 2, and 3, and he's like, oh, I sort of get the story. And then Halo 5 comes out, and he's like, who's Blue Team? And I'm like, well, this is a whole thing. I'm like, let's go to Barnes & Noble's, and I'll buy you some books. Because how else do you know?
Right.
He doesn't have that background, and that's...
Yeah.
You don't want to put a product out there that's it's only for, like, a group of people. Like, it's too inclusive. You want it to be open to everyone. And I felt that with Blue Team wasn't done right, even though the opening cutscene was about as perfect as it gets.
Yeah.
I think I would like to think we'd all agree on that.
Yeah, it was.
I venture a guess in that, and I don't think you guys are wrong, and I don't think that Frank is wrong when he says people love Blue Team. But I really feel like any love that there is towards Blue Team, it is based due to their connection to the Chief. They're on his side. They're helping him fight this battle. They're willing to get court-martialed alongside of him for not, you know, following orders. Their love of Blue Team is, it's like, well, they're on Chief's side. I'm on Chief's side. So, therefore, I love this team because he's fighting with him.
I will say not in my case. I genuinely love Red. I think Last Light and...
I'm talking about for people that don't know... or haven't read books and haven't done comics and haven't, you know, watched Fall of Reach, the Fall of Reach.
I genuinely
just love Fred. But this goes back to what I was just saying. So if you haven't read them, you just assume like, oh, okay, I just like these guys because they're with Chief? Like, is that sort of what you're getting to?
I think so. I think people that don't know any better and only play the games, I think that if they do have a love of Blue Team, it's because they're fighting with the guy they identify with.
I mean, I guess
that,
I could see
or
that.
I actually think that Frank Connor meant he meant that in the way that maybe he was talking about the lore nuts like us. Wasn't talking about the normal people, and that's the people who he was mentioning that love Blue Team, the people who know the lore, which is true. It's entirely true.
But I think those of us that have read the lore, though, I think we're a small part of that community. And so if you're going to talk about the player base and the fan base as a whole, I think you're talking about maybe even the people that just play the games, too. I mean, I'm with you guys. I love Blue Team. I think Linda is severely underutilized on Blue Team. I think they've said in lore in the books, she's probably more OP than Chief is. She's very much in the background, unfortunately.
And Fred is fantastic as well.
Oh, Fred's great. I really wish they would get something. I wish they would have done something in a cutscene with him and the combat knives, because his armor from Halo Legends
Legends, yeah.
I have that action figure with the dual combat knives in the shoulder pauldrons.
Oh, man.
That is
I
awesome.
Thought that, I wish they would have brought that armor in. Like, when Halo 5 dropped, they're like, we're going to give you more armor. So I was like, I want the Fred one from Halo Legends. Like, the package, that was it.
Yep.
Oh, my God. Excellent armor.
Yep, absolutely. So how about the comment? So, I mean, I think we all universally do love Blue Team. But, I think for those of us that are the lore nerds, and I say that with all love and respect because I'm a lore nerd too, we love them because of those characters and what they've become and what they've evolved into. I think that those who don't do that, I think they love Blue Team because they're on Chief's side. How about I think the comment, they like Osiris, I thought that was a bit bold, but I mean, I know, Joe, you said you liked Osiris. Ace, I don't know what your comments are, so I'll get your opportunity to talk about Osiris now. I mean, is he far off from saying people liked Osiris?
I know a lot of people were very hesitant. And I think for the most part, they were cool with it. I actually really like Osiris. I said that. Just to update, Mike Coulter is the actor who plays Locke. Though I think they changed the voice at the end because Coulter got locked up.
Yeah, he came out of Luke Cage. He's a new voice actor.
Yeah, he's doing the Marvel stuff now. But
yeah,
I don't like him as an actor, and I don't know. I feel like that's part of my thing. I think Locke's okay, but I think Mike Coulter, it's him. I don't know. I don't like him as an actor. But otherwise, love Buck. I really like Vale. I thought she would have had a bigger, or I guess more of an interesting part in Hunters in the Dark.
Well, she got lured through the forest of flesh-eating trees. I mean, there was that.
Yeah, but no, but you're not with her at that time. You're with the other, the Spartan spores that are chasing her through that forest. That's how you find out it's a tree-eating forest.
Kodiak and, I forget the other one.
No, it's Kodiak and then he's with the Elite.
Yeah,
and Engineer? Is Engineer with them?
I don't know.
I don't remember. I haven't read
Hunters in the Dark.
So I read the books. I have poor retention of the books.
Oh, I forget. But regardless... do. It's I'd still like her character. Her backstory's cool. Tanaka's backstory I thought was a little like eh.
Tanaka
like I remember
didn't
reading
have a
it.
Backstory. I'm sorry. Yeah. I've read those comics. It wasn't.
Yeah,
much of a
I didn't
backstory.
Enjoy it. I was like, yeah, this is kind of like whatever. So I still like Blue Team. I really like the like I said the story building that they did with them throughout like the first couple missions and even towards the end, like how they would still crack jokes with each other and like. You can tell that they've worked to get to this point. I like their relation, so I'm a fan of Osiris.
Joe, how about you?
I am also a fan of Osiris. I like... ODST is my favorite Halo. So
yeah, me
Buck
too.
Is,
it's the best
Buck
game.
Is fantastic. Yeah. Buck is really fantastic. And with the development that I gave him in New Blood, he became more of a character than he ever was in ODST. And Locke is a pretty interesting character that doesn't really get a lot of justice out of wherever he's made to be. Tanaka is an alright character. I don't really like what she stands for and the concept of her character that much. Well, but I appreciate her inclusion. And Belle is really a really good character. She has a likable personality. She actually shows that they try to make a character out of her.
Yeah, her backstory is excellent. Like she traveled like to some Sangheili world that's like a pretty like Wild West type world, and was just sort of like you know going around taking in the culture and everything. Like that's fucking awesome. Sorry, that's you know pretty great.
There goes the family friendly.
Yeah, I realized as I said it, and I dropped one earlier.
That's all right. I dropped an S word too, so it's all right.
Okay. Quick question for both of you. Do you guys remember in MCC that there was like a teaser, not trailer, but like a teaser cutscene that's a different introduction to how Osiris meets the Arbiter?
Yes, in Halo 2 Anniversary.
Yeah, it was in MCC.
The epilogue and the prologue.
Yeah.
Which is completely different.
Yeah.
And so that was my question. I really thought that was like the first scene going into 5, and I still like what they did in 5, but I think I might have preferred that cutscene, the older one. So this is going to be a tangent, but 2 minutes, I swear, Taz. Which do you guys have a preference, or did you guys enjoy what they did in 5? Because I really did, but I really also enjoyed the old Halo 2 Anniversary one.
I prefer the Halo 2 Anniversary one, to be honest.
Same.
I like the way
and you can make it out in the timeline between Halo 5 and Halo 2 Anniversary.
Yeah.
It was just really cool.
It makes sense.
He's like, you didn't tell me you were hunting the Spartan.
Yeah. Well, I think you could still fit that into the canon for 5. We just, when we're in 5, we miss that part of the conversation.
Yeah.
So I still think it can fit.
Doesn't the Arbiter make a point that it's the first time meeting Locke?
Well, what I'm just saying is I think that conversation can take place at the same... I don't know maybe what I'm trying to say. Like, maybe in 5, we're entering into the conversation between the two after that part has already taken place. Does that make sense?
I guess that's possible, but it doesn't seem likely to me. Yeah. And that's okay. But I'll let you get back to it. I'm sorry.
No,
I just
worries.
Like that original cutscene is awesome.
I feel like our liking of Osiris is kind of an outlier because I think the community as a whole didn't take to us Osiris as well as the rest of us have.
No, Halo Waypoint, the forums were just flooded with, like,
That's Waypoint, though. I take everything from Waypoint, and I take it with a massive grain of salt.
I've posted maybe 8 times on Waypoint over the last, like, 2 years, so I'm not a Waypoint person. Like, at the time, I was just reading it to sort of see what people were posting, and everything on Waypoint is just exaggerated, because everyone's, like, piling on.
I go to Waypoint to find talking points if I'm struggling to find stuff to talk about. Other than that, I just kind of leave it be. Waypoint is really just a place for people that want to complain. And every now and then you get a something that's worthwhile and worth discussing. But for the most part, I think it's just a place where people are like, hey, this is 343's forum, so if I have a problem, I'm going to go here and I'm going to complain about it. But I think for Osiris, like for me personally, I thought Vale was very interesting. And her character is very much a badass. I mean, if you read Hunters in the Dark, I mean, she basically takes out an android at the end with her bare hands before her Spartan augmentations. So just imagine.
I think the term is cyborg. They don't like to be called androids.
Cyborg. My fault. My bad. Cyborg, not android. -1 for Taz. But you know what I mean, though, is she was in a fight for the death against a cyborg and won on her own pre-augmentation. So you see some of her athleticism and stuff in some of the cutscenes, but I think she's really underutilized as a character, unfortunately. Especially with the missions where you're on St. Helios, she should have kind of been at the forefront for those. And she kind of was in some of the dialogue. They referred to her expertise in some areas, but those really should have been her missions to shine, and she was just kind of there. But I really like her as a character. And then people love Buck. I mean, Buck is the personification of Nathan Fillion in Halo. What's not to love? And I think I like his character. I think he's kind of the grounded, down-to-earth guy. He's the one that's trying to...
Well, he's the veteran.
Well, and he's also trying to bring gravity of the situation to Locke. I mean, Locke is doing the, this is just another target. And Buck's trying to say, no, this is not just another target, Locke. We're going after a guy that basically single-handedly saved the galaxy from extinction.
Well, he has the line. He's like, everyone's going to hate us.
Yeah.
Right?
Yep, absolutely.
And his character is just excellent. It's so well-written. And sort of the relationship of that team, you can tell that he's like the glue guy. Everyone sort of plays off him.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just so good.
Mm-hmm.
And so was it just me? But like the first time playing through the game, I wasn't sure. I was like, they can't keep the series going forward with two teams. I thought playing through it, we were going to lose people. I was afraid we were going to lose Buck at the end of 5.
Yeah.
No?
No, I wasn't worried about that. I'm thinking we're going to lose people at 6.
In it.
6 will lose people.
Yeah, same here.
Interesting.
And
okay.
I don't want to lose Fred. So if I lose Fred, I'm just going to cry.
But like I think Buck is universally well liked amongst the community, and I think a lot of that comes from who plays him. Like Ace, you know, Ace isn't a fan of Locke because he didn't like the actor that portrayed him. I think on the opposite end of the spectrum, I think you get a lot of people that like Buck because of the actor that portrays him.
Everyone loves Nathan Fillion.
Absolutely. Yeah. And so then with Tanaka, I think Tanaka's problem is that she's just there, and you could put Tanaka and replace her with any Spartan 4 ever in existence, and it wouldn't have changed a damn thing.
How would you guys have felt about Spartan Gabriel? Thorn?
Thorn was supposed to be in place of Buck.
He was supposed to be Buck.
Yeah.
Yeah. How would you have felt about him there? Because I not to take anything away, but I'm Tanaka really was nothing in the story. Like, as a character, she's really whatever. But, I mean, they put all the effort into, like, building up the character of Thorn.
I would have preferred Thorn and Lockspot.
Right? Wouldn't you have felt... Oh, and Lockspot?
I would have preferred Thorn and Lockspot. And I can get to that a little bit later, too, because I've got kind of a side note here on what I felt would have made Osiris more interesting. One of the things...
Okay, yeah, we can pocket it for that if you want.
Okay, but yeah, one of the things is putting Thorn in Lockspot instead. And for lore people, I mean, Locke, you know, grew up, he had a chief action figure in his home, he was a fan, you know, like everybody else was, and now he's tasked with having to go after him. I think that would have been an interesting dynamic.
Thorn, not Locke.
Thorn. Yeah, well, Thorn in Locke's position. Yeah.
Gotcha. No, no, you said Locke had
Sorry. G-back yeah, no, Thorn did, yeah. You see, they're interchangeable. But yeah, Tanaka,
I was like, dude, I missed the lore.
Tanaka, I feel like you could have injected anybody else in the universe in there, and it would have been the same. And then Locke, I felt he was too by the book, too business as usual to be a main character. He would have been a great side character, I think. But I also think he kind of suffers from the Commander Palmer effect in that I think people portray Locke as not giving Chief the respect he deserves. And so they automatically don't like him. And much like Palmer in her line of, I thought you would have been taller. I don't think people took that in the way that it was intended. And they took it as a dig when it wasn't. And so then people immediately didn't like her because of that. And I think Locke kind of gets that same effect as well.
He just lacks charisma. He lacks anything. Like, yeah. And that's my issue with him as an actor, Mike Coulter. I think he's a terrible actor. Like, watching Luke Cage, I'm like, this guy has no emotion. He shows me absolutely nothing.
Yeah.
Like, I that's how I feel about Locke. But I think the character it's not a bad character.
No, but I don't think I don't think it should be a main protagonist either.
See, they could have had him as, like, you know, the leader of a different Spartan unit, and he's sort of just there in cutscenes, like, or he radios in where you see his face in the corner. He's just like, I said I'm going to take this, and it's like, he needs help. Yep. Go help him.
Exactly.
Yeah, I think you nailed it. Like, that would have been great. But I don't mind that we have Locke at this point. Like, it could have been something else, but it's not. So.
Well, and he didn't undergo any kind of change or evolution in the game either. The Spartan Locke that we meet on the very first mission is the exact same Spartan Locke that we end Halo 5 with. There was no journey of this character.
I would say there is no journey, but I'd say he changed a little bit because at the end he realized that he can't. Why is he hunting Chief? He has to help him. Like, he has to do something to save the world.
I don't know. It just didn't feel like we were on a journey with him. It just felt the same throughout.
There's absolutely no journey. He literally just makes a decision.
Yeah. So I think they miss out. But I think you miss out on that by doing something.
Oh,
like that.
Yes. Yes, that's how you connect with a character. We've seen the Chief subtly develop humor, like his interaction with Cortana throughout the series. Like, you see him change.
Mm-hmm. So kind of going into my sidebar here. So things that I felt like could have made Osiris more interesting. So I talked about putting Gabriel Thorne in Locke's spot, because then you have, you know, Thorne is duty bound and he wants to follow orders, but his orders have him going after somebody he looked up as a hero, as a child, and now he has to hunt down and chase down his hero. I think that would have been a very interesting dynamic, watching him have to bounce his feelings between a sense of duty and sense of chasing after somebody he really looked up to and respected. I think that would have won him some instant sympathy with the player base as well, because I think those are feelings and emotions that people can understand, can relate to, or sympathize with.
What do you think, Joe? Would you have been cool with Thorne over Locke?
Well, in terms of character, yeah, but in terms of story and storytelling, I don't know if I would have been cool with him, because Thorne had his own development, and it was really... It was achieved, and Thorne ended up being the team leader for Majestic. So I was seeing it throwing all that development out the window. I don't know about you guys, but it would have felt like throwing another storyline out the window for the sake of Halo 5.
Oh, that's what happens to Jewel and Dama. Just throw it in there, get it out.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah.
No, but so. I would not have minded if he was part, like I said, in place of Tanaka, but I would not have liked him as the leader of Osiris, just because his personality isn't the assertive type that would be ready to go after Chief. And I get that's what makes him interesting to you, and that he has that conundrum of, this is one of my heroes, but I have to hunt him down. But you need someone like Locke, who's like so like duty-bound, as you said. Like, it's like mission on hand, I have to do it. That's the kind of person you need to hunt down Chief. And that's who you would expect to be brought on when you need to rein him in.
So then if you
they wouldn't bring Thorn.
If you have Thorn in there in Tanaka's place, then you have an internal team struggle, and that could add a different dynamic then as well.
Yeah, but I think that would be more interesting, because then you have someone with, like, a strong fist who'll come down and, like, give orders and, you know, hold the team together. But at the same time, he has to deal with, it sucks to say, but Thorn was always, like, a softer character.
Yeah.
In the comics, yeah. Like, the stories that they added in the comics later, the whole Janus Key thing, which is a sore topic for me. But, like, he's just a soft character. I would not have enjoyed it as much. I would have been like, I cannot believe that he would do anything here. Got to be honest.
Okay. So my other thing then would be going back to Nightfall and making a switcheroo. Spoilers for anybody that's not seen Nightfall. I would have switched and had Locke's character sacrifice himself on the ring, and Aiken and Mercer be the ones that survive and move on. And then Aiken comes. They bring Aiken back into the Spartan Fours to then chase after Chiefs. Now you've got Spartan Two going after Spartan Two.
That's not a bad idea. I honestly thought that Mercer, was that the girl's name?
Yeah.
I thought she would have been brought in, and I was like, oh, maybe she's going to be part of Osiris, because like,
I mean, she wanted to be a Spartan.
Mm-hmm.
She wanted to be Oni and a Spartan. So I honestly thought she was going to be part of it.
I thought so too. Like, it seemed like, oh, okay, like, she pulls through in this situation that's clearly, like, super dangerous. It's obviously, like, classified information. Mm-hmm. And it's like, okay, like, oh, okay, she's sort of proven her worth in the field. And we knew Locke was already going to be the leader of Osiris, didn't we, by that point?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I was like, oh, so maybe this goes hand in hand. Like, this is the introduction to her as well. And not the case.
And the reason
I honestly thought that Bale was going to be Mazer.
Yeah. I really feel, and the reason I put Aiken in that is some of the same dynamics as Thorn is, you know, you got Spartans that are very duty bound, although he's not so much anymore, because I mean he's one of the few Spartans that has quote unquote retired, and he's brought back for this specific task, so he could have some internal conflict with the military for bringing him back, and then you also have some internal conflict as far as you know, these are the orders I have to follow, but now I have to go after somebody that I consider family, that's very close. I mean, as close to a family as I've had. And I just felt like that would have been very interesting from a couple of different perspectives.
Not to mention, Aiken just lost his daughter, in Nightfall.
Yeah, and you make a good point in that. We know he follows that that prototype that Locke is, because he's in Evolutions, and they talk about how when what was the Pariah, I think was the story.
It's the very first Halo one. Evolutions. Is the one where he got beat up by Soren.
Soren, that's his name. I could remember him. They talk about Randall was like beating himself up afterwards because he let him get away, and they're like, "There's nothing he could have done." So we know that, you know, he is part of that Spartan 2, like, I have to complete the mission mindset. And that is the kind of person you would want to hunt down, Chief.
Yeah. All right. So let's go on to one of the other quotes here. So we got another quote from Frank O'Connor from the article. Quote, "Chief, we tend to think of as a kind of vessel for your adventure rather than necessarily this major character in the universe. He's really just your entry into the universe, but people have become attached to him over the last 15 years, and they've started to sort of fill in the gaps that the character deliberately has for gameplay reasons with a genuine emotional attachment. We certainly underestimated that with Halo 5, and I'm going to link that with his other quote. He's weirdly become more and more relevant. I think certainly in Halo CE, he was deliberately almost an empty suit. He's just this fantastic way to enter somebody into the middle of a conflict. The effect that the character has on his surroundings and the fate of the galaxy has had a resonant effect on fans over the years. It wasn't that surprising to me, but the volume of Give Us More Chief at the end of Halo 5 was significant, so I think, if anything, weirdly, slightly more important now than he has ever been, certainly to our franchise." And that was an answer to what is Master Chief? Is he still relevant in games today? So that's kind of what they were talking about there. I agree with the video that I saw from Chief Canuck on this. 343 threw the empty vessel excuse out when they did Halo 4. And when they adamantly and very deliberately went into a, we want to explore Chief as a human, he's not just a machine. So I find it very interesting that they come back at Halo 5 and say, oh, well, we just thought he was just this empty vessel. We're surprised people have this emotional attachment to him when they're the ones that kind of threw the empty vessel thing out the window. What are your guys' thoughts on that?
I mean, I can't understand why they went with the empty vessel excuse, because Halo 4 was a mess. Not in terms of story, but Halo 4 was a mess in community reception. A lot of people didn't like how Halo 4 developed John as a character, so I guess they did a 180 and threw the empty vessel there, because they saw that people don't like John as an empty vessel. They don't like John as a character. So I guess that's why they threw that in. But in terms of doing it right there, I guess it is just an excuse to do it and get out of there quickly. Get out of that question quickly, I guess.
I like I said, I wasn't there. I wasn't following anything with video games when 4 came out. But when I played it, I really enjoyed it. I agree with both of you about the empty vessel thing. Like,
maybe Frank O'Connor was doing the, hey, Halo 5 basically retconned everything from Halo 4, so it didn't exist, so he's still supposed to be an empty vessel, while the rest of us all very much remember Halo 4.
He might have was half.
Because
they just destroy every single storyline that they created after Halo 4.
Yeah. Well, and I'm sorry, you can't say that you're surprised that after 15 years, how relevant and how much he's loved by the community. He's the face of Halo. And for a lot of people, he's the face of Xbox, to be honest. So say that sounds terribly naive, almost, to say, oh, we didn't realize just how loved he was by the player base. Any other comments on that, or want to go ahead? Have we said everything we need to say on that one?
I think I'm good on that.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So, quote, instead of focusing on bringing on new characters into the world and expanding the playable characters, we've sort of shifted the focus a little bit to making the world a little bit more realistic and compelling and, I would say, more fun for players who get to inhabit the Chief in the future, pretty much as they have demanded, end quote. All right, so this is the one that really hit home for me, and not really in a good way, but I'll let you guys go ahead first. Instead of focusing and bringing on new characters into the world and expanding the playable characters, we sort of shifted the focus to making it a little bit more realistic, compelling, and more fun for players who want to inhabit the Chief. Are new playable characters going to die?
Yeah, probably.
Like I said, that was the feeling I had in 5. Yeah. Go on, Joe. Sorry.
It's fine. But I mean, it doesn't necessarily mean that they're going to die. I mean,
is the idea of bringing in more characters into the universe, is that dead?
Probably and probably not.
What do you mean?
Because I mean, he might have meant that as saying, like, we're not gonna focus on them that much, and that doesn't mean they're gonna kill them, but it might as well. But at the same time, it's not a really precise thing to say. I don't know how to explain it right now, but I don't think it necessarily means they're going to kill every single character that they introduce in Halo 5. That's all I'm going to say.
They're not going to Julem Dama everybody in Halo 6?
It doesn't necessarily mean that.
What?
So
10 minutes in, we lose everyone?
10
that
minutes
whole
in.
Storyboard? Gone.
10 yeah? minutes in, a nuke goes off in the middle of Infinity and takes out everybody.
Does anyone watch The Leftovers here?
No.
Ooh. No.
They more or less do that in the third season, where like this whole community group that's sort of been building up for two seasons just gone in like the first 2 minutes, and I was like, Julem Dama all over again. I was like, I can't deal with this.
So I don't necessarily mean kill them off in the literal sense so much as this idea of, I mean, we expanded the amount of in-game characters in the universe in 4, and we further expanded it more in 5. Is the idea of bringing in more characters kind of dead now? And are we just going to take what we have, develop what we've got, but make the single player interaction more chief focused? And is that a good route to go?
Yes and no, but because going into what I was saying to you before we start this, that isn't really the thing that they should have learned from this. We don't need that focus on John. We need better writing in terms of storytelling. And with that, it comes with creating better characters for everyone. So I'm not really into the whole idea that they're going to give more focus to John. And we don't really need that.
Yeah, I sort of hope that they don't just start to, like, push other characters to the side and just sort of blend them in. Like, it just... I feel like they did that with... Well, we didn't see Majestic at all in this game. Or, like, even Palmer. Like, I feel Lasky. Like you gave her... Yeah, Lasky, you gave these people, like, a huge part of the story, but, like, in 4... in the lead up to this, and then what, they just sort of just get pushed off to the side.
Yeah.
So is the quote no new characters or no new playable characters?
Just the focus on bringing new characters in the world. They're going to scale back on bringing on new characters into the world.
So and my hesitation there would be on, so Who are you fighting against, I guess? Because you know it's the created, fine. That's the easy answer. But, so, I mean, that's it? Like, that's where the focus is now? Or does that mean you have to bring back the Flood? Or, like, you know, what are we doing?
My hope, like, is that it goes back to something that's more of an internal struggle with Chief, like it was in 4. And if that's what you're going to do, that's fine. But I think where they missed the mark here, and some of this might be the fault of the community as far as the feedback that we were given. When people talk about the shortcomings of the campaign, reason 1A and reason 1B are not enough Chief, poorly developed characters. And they were kind of interchanged in that 1A, 1B slot. So it looks like what they've taken from this is that they want more Chief, but I hope that they didn't miss out on... That's not the only thing people were saying. People were saying, we need good writing to make characters that we can care about and that go through some sort of metamorphosis throughout the story you're trying to tell. And I think people like myself, I'm concerned that did they get that message too, or did the only message they get was have more missions with Chief?
Well, I hope they got the whole we need more developed characters, because if they didn't, we're gonna just go again in the same mess.
Yeah.
That's everything we have to say about it, really.
So I think, and so the notes I have here, the fact that people wanted more Chief falls in line with this being more of a mainline Halo game, and I think we talked about that a little bit earlier. If this was Halo Guardians, I don't think it would have. I don't think the fact that Chief was only in 3 missions would be as big of an impact, but it's Halo 5 Guardians. So I think when you have a mainline numbered title, people expect Chief to have at least half the screen time, kind of like he did in Halo 2. Halo Reach, ODST, Halo Wars all had mostly positive receptions because people weren't expecting a Chief story, and that left them open to being accepting of new characters. Is kind of what I felt about that.
I'd say I'd agree, because like Joe, my favorite Halo game is ODST. Yep, and I think part of it is because it's so different, and they have the courage to do something different with it. Like, it's open world to an extent. Like, you know, it's not true open world, but it's a contained open world. And it's awesome because you move around, you have to sneak around. There's a lot more to it. It's not a straightforward, like, here's point A, here's point B. There's one way there, go. You can kill everything in sight.
Mm-hmm.
And the vibe is different. Like, aesthetically, it's dark. The music builds a very, like, somber mood. It's a very different experience from any of the other Halo games. Mm-hmm. And I like I said, it's just my favorite one. And I guess to relate it to a different game, Spartan Assault. I got it because I pre-ordered 5, the Ultimate Edition or whatever, like the $100 one, Digital Deluxe. People just said the worst things about that game, and I'd never played it. I never even knew it came out. So I was like, oh, I get this game, whatever, and one day I put it on. I think it's a fun game. It doesn't have to be like Halo 3, Halo 2, Halo Wars. Like, they're trying something new. And like on one of our episodes, I defended the game for like an hour because I enjoyed that they took the time to, like, whatever. It wasn't successful, but they tried something new there.
Yeah.
And tried two of them.
Yeah. And I like them, you know. I think if you go in expecting something else, you're going to be really disappointed. But they're cool for what they are. They're mobile games. Like, you can play in the Halo universe on the go, like on the train, in the car.
And I think to your point, you know, it's you're not expecting, you know, with Reach and ODST, you're not expecting a Chief story. Reach, you're expecting a Spartan story, but like in ODST, I don't even think there's a Spartan in the game at all, period. And I think it's about managing those expectations, making sure you're sending a clear message through your campaign leading up to the game, what it's about. And I think that if you do it the right way and you're transparent, the general public and player base is open to giving it a try. I mean, people may not have liked Spartan Assault, but there's a lot of people that at least went out and tried it and played it and gave it its due. So, I think so long as that you set it up that way, and it's not a mainline Halo title, I think you will get a lot more acceptance by the player base that choose to play it, that they will be accepting of characters other than the Chief. Sergeant Forge from Halo Wars is a beloved character in the Halo canon because he was never, I don't think he was ever set up as being at odds as to take over the franchise from the Chief. He was the face of Halo Wars, and people generally accepted that, and I think he's a well-liked character because of it.
People love Emil.
Yeah.
People love Carter.
Yep.
You know, there's so many cosplayers who do those characters.
Yep.
You see June. Yeah, you see Noble Six. And it's because, like, they have their own little part to the bigger story. And it doesn't have to line up in that main, like, Chief, you know, A to B storyline of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Yep.
Like, they have a little snippet on the side. And it's fun. Like, you can go away from the mainline game and just enjoy the game for what it is. Like I said, ODST, by far my favorite game.
Yep, me too.
And I'd never played ODST till MCC. So, like, I'd played those other games that came after it, and then I was just like, oh my god, this game is the best of everything I've ever played.
Oh, you missed out on ODST Firefight then. For my money.
Oh no, I went back, and I bought
it. Okay, good.
And I brought out the old 360, and people are still online. Like, I've played.
For my money, the best version of Firefight.
Oh, it is. It is, without a doubt.
Yeah.
So I have a funny little story, and I've said this on Let's Talk Halo, my show, but I don't know if – I know Joe hasn't heard this. Maybe you have, Taz. So I got ODST because it was $5 as a DLC in MCC, and I was like, oh, you know, cool. I've never played this game. Downloaded it, started playing it, and could not stop. Like, ran through the story straight through the first time I played it. Amazing. I finish the game, and, you know, you start unlocking the achievements. I get one achievement that says, complete the game without visor. I'm like, what in the world is visor? Because at the start of ODST, they're like, oh, do you want to go through the instructions? And I was like, I've played Halo before. I don't need the instructions. So I never knew there was a visor button. And I kid not, the first mission where the helmet's in the TV, I was there for like 45 minutes running up and down those stairs looking in every room. I'm like, where is this beat coming from? Oh my god. It was the most frustrating thing.
I always hit the visor now trying to reload.
So that is one of the small things of ODST that will forever make me smile that I got that achievement without trying. Just had no idea.
So kind of going back to other characters, the other takeaway from it, and this kind of projects out Halo into the future. If the takeaway is no new characters or development of those characters, it's the wrong way out. Halo still needs new and well-developed characters in its games. While Chief is important, he doesn't exist in a vacuum, and he can't last forever. At some point, the franchise does need to move to another main antagonist. There just isn't something as exciting about an action hero ass-kicker that also qualifies for the senior citizen discount at Denny's. yes, I get the Expendables, but that was the exception, not the rule, and that was more of a nostalgia thing than an actual viable franchise. So, somebody that can eat their dinner at 4 and go to bed by 6 as an action hero doesn't really scream AAA title for me. At some point, we're going to have to try to move the game to somebody else to take over the mantle. Chief is, he's almost into his 50s by this point, is he not?
Should be.
Yeah. So, I mean...
47 years old.
Okay, so there's going to have to start to be a changing of the guard, and they're going to have to think and plan that changing out very carefully for that change to be accepted amongst the people that really love the Chief.
And I agree. I mean, I completely agree that we should actually change the pace of a protagonist in Halo. Because these people are not gonna live that long.
No.
And especially John. John is gonna run out of luck sometime.
And he needs to go out like a badass. He can't retire. I don't wanna see Master Chief with a walker with tennis balls on the bottom.
I don't wanna see him giving me orders from like Oni.
Yeah.
Me either.
All right.
But have you read my post about John's death?
No.
No.
Well, I actually suggest that he should die like a dog in the battlefield. Not really in a meaningful way, but it should be that way because he should die without special treatment. He's always been that kind of guy that doesn't like special treatment.
He needs to go ahead, sorry.
He needs to go out without any fanfare. He needs to go out like a real person.
I don't know about that.
When you said he needs to die like a dog, and it might sound messed up, but immediately the death of Cat comes to mind.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, it was just so like, oh, really? Like, that's really disappointing.
Yeah.
And this is for a character that, like, obviously we didn't even know. It's like, you could have done better. But I agree he should probably go out on the battlefield. My one issue is that they sort of already gave Kurt that death in Ghost of Onyx, the one that, like, I feel like would be fitting for Chief.
Yeah.
Like, him tossing, like, Fred... kicking him out of like a pelican and crashing the pelican into like save the world, and that's the death.
Yeah.
But you can't do that again now that Kurt's done it.
Or Carter.
I wasn't even thinking.
You can actually do it. You have to shake it up. And the way I think about it is that he should die making the last action in a battlefield. The action that makes every soldier in that battlefield have some hope.
That I could get behind. I mean, his death needs to be impactful. Like my fear is like Ace was saying, Cat's death was not impactful. It was like, oh, that just happened. Now, Chief's death needs to be impactful, but it needs to be impactful in a very, very, very big way for it to be accepted by the fan base, in my opinion.
And that's the death I suggest. I don't suggest that he should go with no meaning behind it. I suggest that he should go out like a real human being, like he's being built out to be, but in a meaningful way, doing something that actually makes sense and really qualifies as his legacy.
The only one that really went out in a meaningful way in Reach, I think, was Carter.
No, Emil.
Oh, yeah, Emil.
Yeah.
But, like, George's death his death was absolutely for nothing, because as soon as he blew up that carrier...
Well, they showed it afterward. But in his mind...
Well, in his mind, wherever he
I give him the credit. I loved him as a character. I just love Noble Team. That might just be me. But you're absolutely right. Like, in real world conversation, their real world, it was meaningless, yeah. But.
All right. So let's see. The last quote from Frank, and then I'll talk about the quote from the community update. There's always a call and response element of shipping a game. You have to ship improvements. You have to ship tweaks. You have to ship changes. And sometimes you have to walk some of those back. Doubling down on the Master Chief story and the amount of focus on him was probably the easiest learning from Halo 5. That was a really simple thing to absorb and embrace. And I think that just kind of goes back to the conversation we had. If it's a mainline Halo game, Chief should be the focus, or at least get half the screen time if you're going to try to do a double story like Halo 2 and Halo 5. But what do you guys think about the doubling down on the Chief story moving forward with the next Halo game?
I'm torn on it. I mean, I like sort of want to see what Osiris does as well now. And that what we didn't get to in the last talking point was Chief can't be there forever, really. Like,
yep.
I don't want to keep playing as him for the next two or three games. Like, it was supposed to be the second trilogy, and now it's not a trilogy anymore, right? It's a saga.
Yep.
And, like, I love Chief, but I'm ready for him to go. It's going to be very sad, but I don't want to keep playing as him forever. Only because he is getting old, and, like, these games keep jumping years.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and, like,
I mean,
that's it.
The first trilogy was just over the span of a few months.
Like 3 months?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was like end of September to end of November, right? Something like that.
Yeah.
August.
Yeah.
I think it was August.
August
to November.
To November, I think.
Or 27th or something. I don't know.
Yeah, because Reach fell around November, and then they found Installation 4. And then Halo 2 happened and Halo 3.
Reach fell in...
So it was just...
August.
Reach fell in August.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Between
August and November.
And I think September, it was in September, because I've the Flood, the book The Flood, they have them coming out of Slipspace early September at Installation 04. And then you've got September till I think November, December, something like that.
It has to be November. Because the war ended in 2552, so it didn't
So it was before the end of the year. So yeah, you're looking at 4 months, 3-4 months.
Yeah, because you have to factor in the flip space time travel.
And then the what was it in First Strike? The time shift bubble that they went into to be able to go back in time to make to make it line up with Halo 2. Oh man, Bungie did some interesting things to make their extended universe work. Or not work, or they completely ignored it.
At least it wasn't nanobots.
They ignored it.
Nanobots, yeah. Nanobots. Oh, my God. But yeah, no, I agree. I mean, at some point, he is going to have to go. I'm okay with doubling down on his story if his story is coming to an end.
Yeah, but with the announcement that they're just going to double down on the focus with him, it doesn't really scream, we're going to kill him, to me. It screams, we're going to continue to use him.
Yeah.
And that's not a good thing. Because, like you guys said here, I don't want to continue playing as John for the rest of my life.
Yeah. And don't talk about prequel games. And it made me roll my eyes. I was like, no, you don't keep milking it by going before everything again, because then you just have, then that just opens up the door for EU problems like Halo Reach did.
So Halo 3 opens up November 17th, 52.
Okay. And the difference being that the portal from the Earth to the Ark was an instantaneous portal, whereas Slipspace actually takes time off the clock.
Yes.
Yeah. That's how they were able to get everything to fit in such a short period of time.
And it's funny because you have all these years that you don't get to see, and all of them are pretty interesting, and you'd like to see them.
I've talked about this on Twitter. I would love to see a Kilo 5 game that is in the form of, like, say, like Tom Clancy Splinter Cell type of game.
I've said this as well. Like, I think that would be awesome. That would be an amazing game. I got to be honest, I normally hate when people, like, because that, you know, we all do it, but they're just like, oh, a Halo game that's like this kind of game. But I think it would be cool if they did something on Trevelyan, and it would be like a co-op. So you know how, like, Watch Dogs is supposed to be like a two-player or a team of two type thing?
Yeah.
Do something like that in third person, like Gears, about Tom and Lucy. And you have Mendez, like, giving you orders and whatnot, giving you intel.
And you've got the lead-in for that kind of game with Fractures.
We have the story, yeah.
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 So it looks like the last Halo, the last campaign mission in 3 is December 11th, 2552.
So it does go into December.
So, yeah.
Okay.
So, yeah.
But yeah, so
we fact-checked.
The first three games take place over a couple of months, and then you get this big gap of almost 5 years, and then we go into the next set of games. So
57, yeah. Yeah.
So, I mean, there's pros and cons to both. I think the pros definitely being those who are really big fans of the Master Chief are really going to get psyched about that. And it continues that story, and it continues to dive into him as a human, which I think is good. But I think we've already talked about the cons of that, as far as people don't want to continuously have to play the same character, especially as he gets older. It becomes more difficult, and to keep him in that type of environment. So the last thing was actually out of the last community update. And it was basically a response to people's responses to Frank's comments. And so it says, and quote, Frank's comments about lessons learned from Halo 5's campaign seem to have parts of the community in a bit of an uproar. First, it's important to note that there's a lot of speculation and assumptions being made out there. The next major Halo game hasn't even been announced, let alone any details about what the story may entail. Rest assured that while the studio has received feedback that players wanted to see more Master Chief in Halo 5, that's far from the only learnings the team has taken to heart. We are absolutely aware of the sentiment around the disconnects between the game's marketing versus what transpired in-game, as well as issues such as the lack of split-screen functionality, to name a few examples, and are always striving to learn and improve going forward. We'll have plenty more to say when the time is right, end quote. So maybe kind of allaying or assuaging some of the fears about what a lot of the people in the lore community are concerned about. Next Halo game. I mean, when do you guys think we're going to start getting information about what is going to be next for Halo?
E3 this year.
E3.
Yeah. There's no way they're not going to announce something.
Maybe a teaser trailer like they did. Remember, and this I do, someone did send to me, was the desert trailer of Chief in the cloak.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like it leading up to 4, like, right? Something like that. Like, you know, and that was a quick teaser. And they didn't really reveal much there. It was just like, oh, look at this. Something is coming. Or was the Guardian in that? I don't even remember.
Yes.
It looked very different, but yeah, it was.
Okay. Well,
it looked better.
I have a reason to think that we're probably going to see something from the TV series.
I doubt it.
Well, they have been talking a lot about it.
And they have confirmed it is still going.
But they haven't even started production on it.
The last update I said is that it's still in the works.
It's still in development.
Hey, until they say that it's not in development anymore.
Yeah, but development is different from production. Like,
no, I get that.
Okay, yeah. I'm making it abundantly clear.
I know that there's no cast and there's no writing or anything like that going on that we know of. We just know that it's still out there. I would like to see that. The project
is still alive.
I would like to see that, but you know, the only thing, and this may be an unpopular opinion, I'm hoping there's nothing about a Halo 3 anniversary.
I would hate that. It would be a waste of time.
Yep. I agree. We don't need it again. You can already play it on Xbox One. We don't need it
there.
Yep.
And it's going to look even better on the Scorpio. There's no need for it. It's a waste of time, a waste of resources. If you're going to do something like we were saying earlier, do something new.
Yep.
A side story, different. Spartan Assault, Spartan Strike, ODST. Even Reach, even though Reach is a mainline game with like a different story in terms of playability.
Is Reach considered a mainline game, or is that considered a spinoff?
No, no.
I'd consider that a spinoff.
Oh, well, no, no. I mean, in terms of mechanics.
I
meant mainline instead, and in terms of mechanics.
Okay.
Because you are playing as a Spartan.
Okay, I see what you're saying.
And you do play, you know, it's a straightforward shooter. As opposed to like ODST, where like he throws the grenade funny because he's a human. Like you don't have the armor, the Mjolnir.
Right.
So that's what I meant. I'm sorry. Yeah. Like do something like that with those resources. Why waste it? We don't need these. The cutscenes still look amazing on the 360, let alone the one. Like there's no need for it.
I'd be interested in cutscenes done by Blur, but it's not a necessity. It's a
They're
want.
Too expensive.
It's a want. It is not at all a need. It's like if I have this wish list, this would be an easily top three of my wish list that I would like to have, but I don't need it. And if it's gonna pull time and resources away from the next game, I'd rather go to the next game.
And not even that. The only thing I want from Halo 3 Anniversary, and if it happens, is for them to actually adding the new lore stuff, like the fact that Us and the other guy were in the assassination of Truth, or the new Memorial Hill from Halo 5, and that's pretty much it. Do details.
Yeah, but again, I don't know if I'd want to have them spend the resources and the time and the energy to do that when they could just work on the
exactly.
next game. Yep.
Dude,
exactly.
Blur is up the wazoo in terms of cost.
Well, and you get what you pay for because their stuff
is
amazing.
No, I'm not saying I love it. It's
No, I know. I'm just saying they are that way because they have earned it because their stuff is
gorgeous. No, of course.
Gorgeous.
But I'm just going back to we're saying like it would be a complete waste of resources when they can put that money into actually developing something new and different.
Absolutely.
Or improving what they already have, you know?
Absolutely.
I understand it would look amazing, but you know, the cutscenes as is still look great.
Yep.
They almost look they do look amazing to me.
Yep.
It's not Blur, but doesn't mean it's bad. And it's in my mind, it's just a waste of money. Like there's so much they could be doing. Like we have, you know, I'm cool with a gap year. Like I don't need a new Halo every year. But it'd be cool if like, you know, every other year, like every 2 years, they give us something, you know, like I said, something different. And it doesn't even have to be like on the scale of a Halo 5. And like, oh, it's this massive game. It looks amazing. Like, I want it to look good, but like, give me something small, like an ODST. It doesn't have to be a full campaign.
Not every Halo game needs to be AAA.
Yeah. Or you know what I thought was really cool? So I'd played Gears of War 3 before I stopped playing video games. And when I came back, I haven't played 4, but I did play Judgment, the like spin-off game.
Baird,
right?
The 3. Prequel? Yeah.
Yeah. I thought that was a great campaign because it's firefight, but told in an interesting story. Mm-hmm. So they just revolved, they made maps and revolved the firefight platform around that. Like, I thought it was great. You know, what was it, like a 3-hour campaign, maybe 4 hours? And it was well worth it. Like, they could do something like that with the firefight system they have. They would just have to put it on campaign maps.
No. Well, so then,
I actually think like, they took the what we have with Warzone and placed Spartan Ops on it. That'd make it a pretty good game.
No. All right, guys. Any other final comments that we want to make about this magazine article? Again, it's Games TM. It's a British publication. I couldn't get a hold of a physical copy, but if you want to get it, you can subscribe to it online and be able to see it there. There are some other comments, as Ace pointed out. Kiki Wolfkill talked about MCC and their disappointment internally and their heartbreak with how that transpired. So if you guys are interested, go check those out. Any other additional comments from you guys?
From me, not really.
Okay.
Yeah, I like to think we had a good conversation on all the aspects of the interview that we saw.
Cool. All right.
Yeah.
So I'll briefly touch on HCS, and then we are going to call it a day. So the HCS got kicked off again on Saturday. They did an online seeding qualifier for the upcoming UMG Daytona. That is May 12th to 14th, so 2 weeks out. I don't know. I don't know what day it is anymore. 2 weeks. So in 2 weeks, everybody is going to be in Daytona, on the beach, and in the arena, playing some Halo 5. So they did a seeding tournament because, obviously, all these Halo tournaments, they're all doing them bracket style right from the get-go. They're not doing any group plays or anything like that. So anybody that's not one of the seven established Pro League teams are all competing in these qualifiers. They're getting seeding points. So that way when they get to Daytona, they have a way to seed all of these teams. I watched zero of any of the matches for the online qualifier. If I recall, it wasn't even streamed on Twitch. I think they streamed the semifinals and finals, but all the other matches leading up to, you're going to have to rely on individual players actually streaming those. For those of you that are interested, a team captained by Randa won the first qualifier. I believe it was Randa, Baby J, Commonly, and Skeptical, who's actually the manager for Straight Rippin', which I thought was kind of weird. They ended up coming out on top. And we had another bit of interesting news. And interesting news usually seems to follow Kratos.
I was going to mention this.
Quite. I feel like the guy almost does it on purpose now just to see how much he can troll. They go out and they get a very, I at least give them credit. They went out and they found a sponsor that is not a normal, org or sponsor for esports. Insight is an Insight clothing company it's a clothing company, has 13 followers on Twitter. Their logo nice. Is
more than me.
Well, yeah, their logo is, extremely similar to the Optic Gaming logo. Like, to the point I've seen people Photoshop the Insight logo on top of the Optic Gaming logo. To me, it was just kind of one of those, what can we do to try to troll the Halo community? Oh, we're going to do this. Yeah, let's do it because it's funny. That's just kind of the impression I got off of that. Ace, what did you think about that when you came across that?
Yeah, I'll be honest. I didn't see that. I thought you were going to mention how wasn't he complaining that they should have had a straight entry?
Yes.
Oh no, there was that, and then Kratos was didn't he complain because he wanted them to pay for his team to go to Daytona?
Yes. Okay. So,
and obviously he doesn't have an org because he dropped them right before Worlds, right?
So, yeah, so just kind of recap for people that might have missed it. During the Las Vegas qualifier for Worlds, his team, Denoxide, Nated, and Straight Sick. They were picked up by Panda Gaming a couple of weeks before Las Vegas. So Panda Gaming, you know, paid for their way to get out to Las Vegas to attempt to qualify for Worlds. They go out, shock the world. They finish fourth, so they qualify for Worlds through Vegas. And I think a week or two after, or no, I want to say it was a week before Worlds, the team dropped the org. They dropped Panda Gaming so that way they could go to Worlds because ESL was paying the way for all the players and all the teams. They were paying their airfare and their hotel to attend Worlds. So they didn't need Panda Gaming's resources for that.
And that means more resources for them if they win, right?
So instead of splitting whatever cut of whatever they win with the org, they dropped the org and just went as the crowd pleasers. Now, that's all speculation. None of that's been confirmed. But I think it can be just from observation, I think that's a pretty safe bet to say this is what went down. So come to, you know, we're gearing up for the summer season. We've got this open at Daytona. Well, wouldn't you know it, Kratos' team is having a really difficult time finding an org to pay for them to go to Daytona. gee, I wonder why. And I think I even posted a tweet at Kratos when he was bringing this up, and I was just like, there are consequences to actions that you, or there are consequences to the decisions you make, both positive and negative, and I just left it at that. And he didn't respond, and he's responded to my tweets before, so I think he kind of knew where I was going. Spartan the dog, who is taken Nated, I think he's taken Nated spot on that team. He was sending out tweets. Why won't an org come out and sponsor us? We've got all this talent, and yet we don't have orgs that don't want to touch us. And I didn't, but I just kind of be like, well,
he knew what he was getting into.
Look what you're getting into. I mean, you've got You got Kratos, who is widely like the most toxic, polarizing figure in esports right now. If you're going to team with him, you're going to be part of whatever drama he brings along. And Kratos doesn't care. I mean, he almost thrives off it, I think. He really gives no bones about what people think about him and what's going on, and eventually that's going to come back to bite them. So they didn't have a sponsor or anything for Daytona. Kratos's and his team's thinking is that they should automatically get a bid for the championship bracket because they are actually a championship team or a pro league team. They have a pro league spot. The way they got that pro league spot was, as you would expect, somewhat shady. But they have it. So under complete technicality, yeah, they probably should have an automatic bid into the championship bracket. But I don't know what the exact reasoning is behind them having to go through the open, but they're having to do it. So,
quick shout out to the Let's Talk Halo HCS correspondent Los Berger, who was actually the one who filled me in on the Kratos situation.
Los Berger, who was on he was a guest on my show last week.
Berger, that's right.
Quarter pounding me right out of the Halo Bowl.
Oh, that should have been in my introduction.
Should have.
I would like to say co-captain of the second place Halo Bowl team this past season.
Yeah. And who did you beat to get there?
You guys, right?
Yeah, that's right.
That's right.
Hey, you know, we made it.
I've called it. I still want to see the third place game.
Well, if I can get a hold of anybody from Delta Halo, we'll
very true.
is
that a forfeit?
I would say so. But anyway, I mean, Kratos is going to make himself the center of the story regardless. That's just what he is. That's what he likes to do. And he's got fans and people that are behind him that are all for it. And, you know, that's fine if that's what you want to do, if that's kind of the perception you want to have. Hey, you know what? That's cool. That's fine. But don't be surprised when the music stops and you don't have a chair to sit in anymore because of the decisions that you've made in the past. So that's just my whole opinion on it. I don't know him. I don't know him personally. I have nothing against him personally. I just, my opinions are just a complete response to observing the behaviors that I see. I worked in behavioral health for years, so that's just kind of what I do. I observe behaviors and draw conclusions from them, and that's the conclusion that I've drawn. All right. So like I said, UMG Daytona is on May 12th to 14th. It will be on Twitch. It will be on Beam. No word yet on if they're going to broadcast on Facebook and Twitter like they did Worlds, but I would assume they had really good success with that, so they may try that again. The prize pool, I believe, is $100,000. First place coming home with $50,000, and then the rest being distributed amongst the rest of the top eight, I believe. So that's the other thing. You have to finish in the top eight to even come home with a payday. So that could be a very rough trip for a lot of people. And I think that's about it for HCS. So we'll move on to the close of the show. Late, a dollar short. Be sure to give the show a follow on all of our social media. We are on Twitter at Bad Halo Show, on Facebook, facebook.com/Bad Halo Show, and we also have our Discord chat, and the link will be in the show description. And you can also find the Bad at Halo Show on YouTube. If you want to get together for me for games, my gamer tag is Tasman29 on Xbox. Joe, if you mind, go ahead and plug all your stuff. Where can everybody find you?
Well, you can find me on Twitter at HaruspexofHell. You can find my stuff on Twitter as well, which is my link to my WordPress, HaruspexofHell.wordpress.com. And you can join us on the Progressive Halo Discord at Progressive Halo on Twitter. There's a link in the description of the account.
Awesome. Ace, your turn. Yours is going to be much shorter, so that's why you're second.
Fair enough. I am the Junior Ace, THEJRACE. That is my gamer tag. That is my Instagram handle. You can find my show, the show I co-host, I should say, with Real Mystery, Let's Talk Halo, on realmystery.com. I'm sure there are links there. It's one of the tabs. You'll see it.
Awesome.
And yeah, I guess that's it, man.
Cool. All right, so before I go, some quick shout-outs to Evolution League Gaming. Currently, they are still looking for some players in some of their teams for Call of Duty, CSGO, and Gears of War. They do have a Halo team up and running, and I need to reach out to them, get them on the show. Hopefully, they plan to head out to Daytona, so it'd be nice to have some up-close and personal response from some guys over in Daytona.
Did you say they're looking for some Halo players?
They have Halo players. We actually have ELG has a team of four for Halo, and I think they're going to Daytona. I got to reach out to Fate's End, who is the head of ELG, and see about getting those guys on.
Yeah, well, if any orgs out there looking for a high gold, maybe low plat player, great support, I'm all in.
Right, and he's always willing to learn. I always see him on Burger's Twitch channel getting shot in the face and Burger telling him what he did wrong. So eventually he should be able to turn that around.
I direct you to the Halo Bowl videos. I did okay.
So if you guys feel you have what it takes, hit up ELG Nation on Twitter. They're at ELG_Nation. And thank you to their sponsors, including Insane Labs, Jersey Legion, and Ewin Racing. Help support the guys that help support me. Also wanted to do a shout-out to Team Outcast and Halo United for all their support and spreading the word about the show on Twitter. So with that, guys, my Spartan is dead, and I will catch you guys on my next respawn. I want to, again, thank HaruspexofHell and the Junior Ace for coming in and talking some Halo with me. And until I come back in again, as always, don't be like me. Finish your games with a positive KD. Later. Wash away! Wash away! Yeah.